of it, which is handling the introduction to the course. I'm going to share the screen again. And here you are going to start considering the solar radiation introduction. What we are interested in here is the characteristics of solar energy outside the Earth atmosphere. This is what we call extraterrestrial radiation. The wavelength range we are interested in is this. If you remember what we have covered in heat transfer earlier when we were talking about thermal radiation, we said that thermal radiation is limited by a certain wavelength. And the practical range of the wavelength is given here, going from 0.25 up to 3 micrometers. Below this and above this, there is radiation, but not thermal. So thermal radiation is basically limited to that. Maybe below that, as we will see in the spectrum, there are like radio waves or so. Above that, there are some sort of gamma waves or so. These are X-rays is a sort of radiation, but it's not thermal. The second major topic in this chapter is about the geometry. Solar to Earth kind of orientation. And how this orientation is going to change the energy which is received by the sun. Next thing that we are going to consider is the extraterrestrial radiation on horizontal surface that represents the upper limit of the solar radiation that we can make use of. Understanding of this elements that we have in this slide are basically some sort of the basic foundation you need to move into the next chapter. So we're going to look at this as some sort of, if you know the Lego game, where you have some blocks and you're putting all the blocks together to make a certain shape. And this is basically what we are going to do. The sun itself is defined to be of a spherical shape that is made up of intensely hot gases. It have an estimated diameter, as you can see here, 1.39 into 10 to the power of 9 meter. And the distance on the average from the Earth is 1.5 into 10 to the power of 13 meters. As seen from the Earth, if you are sitting on the Earth, you are going to have the feeling that the sun rotates on its axis about every 4 weeks. The matter is that from the space, the Earth is the one that rotates. However, it does not rotate as a solid body. But the equator takes about 27 days, and the polar takes about 30 days of rotation. The sun has an effective black body temperature of 5777 Kelvin. We have used these values before in heat transfer, if you remember, that we assume that the sun is a black body and the black body has a temperature of 5777 Kelvin. The temperature in the core of the sun, in the central interior, is, we're talking about somewhere 8 million to 40 million. And the density is about 100 times the density of water. Density of water is 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter. This is 100 times this value. The energy produced in the interior of the sun is millions that should be transferred to the surface and then radiated outside. This is some sort of an estimation of the temperatures at different radii as, or at different values of the radius from the core of the sun. So 90% of the energy is generated in the region from the core of the sun up to a diameter of 0.23 of the outer diameter, which means that almost quarter of the radius that contains about 40% of the mass of the sun. At a radius of about 0.7, the temperature drops to 130,000 Kelvin. The density drops to about 70 kilograms per cubic meter. And then the convection processes, when we are talking about motion, then we are talking about convection, are beginning to be important. And then from this port, from this part up to the surface, so from here until you reach to the surface, then it, we call it a convective zone. Within this zone, the temperature drops to about the value that we mentioned, 5,000 or 5,000 or 5777 Kelvin, and it has a density of 10 to the power of minus 5 kilogram per cubic meter. So this is some sort of general sort of information that are given about the sun itself. The figure that we see here is showing how the Earth is, can be related to the sun. The value that we mentioned earlier, which is the solar constant, is being given here. That is 1367 watt per meter square. This is the Earth and its diameter, and the sun and its diameter, and then the distance between both of them. The distance between both of them is not really constant, because the Earth is rotating in sort of an elliptical motion around the sun. So the distance is not really constant, but it does not vary much. You see, when they are too far from each other, this is the distance. When they are closest, this is the distance. And the average difference between them is about 1.7%. The radiation emitted by the sun is assumed to be fixed. And that's what we are going to deal with or handle or look at as what we call the solar constant. So the solar constant, which is G solar constant, is the energy from the sun per unit time received on a unit area of surface perpendicular to the direction of propagation of waves. So this is how the solar constant is defined, and this is the value given for the solar constant as 1,367. From heat transfer, this is something that we know. Radiation is emitted due to the matter. Actually, from heat transfer, we have learned that anybody, any surface above zero Kelvin starts to emit radiation. And that radiation is moving in the form of electromagnetic waves. And these waves are moving within a material or moving in complete vacuum. And that's how the solar energy is reaching to the surface or the tip of the atmosphere. And this is how we are going to see that some of the applications of solar energy is to use evacuated tube collectors. So that, you know, in vacuum does not allow conduction heat transfer to occur, does not allow convection heat transfer to occur. It only allows radiation heat transfer to go through. And there are some industrial applications that are making use of that. Yes, go ahead, please.
Can I ask what thermal radiation mean? Because you can take heat from microwave. We do it always, and it's not little.
Please, I did not get your voice clearly. Can you repeat again?
I said, what is the meaning of the thermal radiation? Because we can get thermals from microwave radiation. We do it always in the microwave.
Yes, this is right. Actually, the difference is the electromagnetic waves that are resulting in heating. This is basically what is transmitted or what is looked at thermal radiation. What happens? You have a source. This source is at a certain temperature. And because it is at a certain temperature, it starts to emit radiation. So the radiation emittance here is basically originated from a higher temperature of the surface. And then it is going to propagate through all mediums in all directions until it is received by another surface. This surface, if it is at a lower temperature, then it is going to absorb part of this radiation. So we have energy, which is held by surface. this energy is emitted in the form of electromagnetic waves. The waves are falling into another surface. Part of these waves is being absorbed. So the only reason for the transfer of energy here is difference in temperature. The microwave is different. In the microwave, basically what you do, we are going to energize molecules of water. And the molecules of water that are going to be energized are going to have some sort of spinning and vibrational energy that results in local increase in the heat, in temperature. And this is how the microwave heating occurs. Did I answer your question?
You did, but somehow I am not getting it very much.
Then probably what I would urge you to do, let's take this as I'm sort of a reading exercise. Let's get into the, for example, let's Google on how exactly the microwave ovens are operating. I'll try to search for a video for that. Maybe if you can just share it with us so that the picture becomes clear. But this, the major difference that, or the major takeaway that I want you to get from this question that you made, that you raised is, number one, for radiation, for thermal, to call it thermal radiation, it is something which is originated by difference in temperature. Anybody at a temperature greater than zero Kelvin starts to emit radiation naturally without having to create anything. You don't have to have electric energy to energize a certain emitter so that it can move the molecules of waters and add energy into it. It's something which is occurring naturally just because of the temperature difference. It is actually occurring over a spectrum. Now you can see the wavelength range in front of us, and there is a part here which is going from basically it's 0.1 to 100, or broadly speaking, talking about from 0.25 up to 300, or the range of thermal radiation, below which and above which it is not really a natural sort of the radiation. For example, you can have an X-ray, but when somebody has a broken arm and he goes to the X-ray, his arms does not get heated. Right? The radio waves are there, but when you are opening the radio, it's not heated because of the radio waves, because they are not carrying energy in the form of heat with them. The microwave needs some sort of artificial energizing so that you can start it. So it's not just starting because of temperature differences, which is only in this range of the wavelength, going from the ultraviolet to the end of, or to the lower end of the infrared, or lower end in terms of frequency, but it is the longer wavelength range. So it is something which is, we can say, distributed over a range of the wavelength, and it's not distributed evenly. That you'll find that thermal radiation is higher at a certain wavelength compared to the others. And that's the natural, and that's the nature of it.
Doctor, yes. But in this course, we will not take the full thermal radiation. We'll take only part of it, yeah?
Exactly, you are going to take the part of the radiation which is related into the spectrum of the solar energy alone. We're not going to cover it all, yes.
Okay, clear.
This is another figure, which is a replot of the one that was there in the previous slide. And this is adding an additional information. First, number one, this is the visible light range, which is going from a little bit lower than 400 nanometer to a little bit greater than 700. And this is how it falls in terms of the spectrum that has gamma rays here, X-rays here, ultraviolet, this is the beginning of the solar radiation, and then visible light, infrared, and then the radio waves, radar waves, and so on. And all of these are not thermal radiation. And there is a certain relation between the wavelength and the frequency that you have taken in physics courses before, and the relation is given here, that the frequency is the speed of light divided by the wavelength. So to talking about longer wavelength. If the wavelength are long, then frequency is small. If the wavelength are short, the frequency is high. And short wavelength radiation is the effective one. Now, the relation between the energy and the frequency is given by the Planck relation here, where the energy is equal into the Planck constant into the frequency. This is the distribution of the energy over the wavelength. I said earlier that it is not evenly distributed over the wavelength spectrum, but it is actually changing from one wavelength to the other. And this is why, if you do remember in radiation heat transfer, when you cover this part, you have talked about what we call the monochromatic emissive power, which is the radiation power at a fixed value of the wavelength versus a total emissive power, which is the emissive power which is covering the area under this curve, which is the area or the thermal radiation covering by the whole spectrum that we have. And there is a partial value, and the partial value is covering a certain range of the wavelength. And to remember, there was one of the questions that were given is estimate how much is the solar the energy which is produced by solar or by the sun over a certain wavelength. So you are actually calculating some sort of what we call a subtotal emissive power. Subtotal means you are talking about a certain range of the wavelength, and we'll be seeing that in a while. So this is what we call the spectral radiation curve, which is given by the WRC, which is this, what's called the world standard spectral radiation. It's actually called World Radiation Center, which came up with a standard shape of how the thermal radiation can be a function of the wavelength, and it's all going to show that shape. Actually, this shape changes based on the temperature. What we see here is solar, so we're assuming that the source is at a temperature of about 577 Kelvin. If you are going different sources at lower temperatures, then different versions of this figure are there below it. And there comes the, if you remember from the heat transfer, the Wien's displacement law, which is taken the top of each one of them. And that actually is related to how the temperature changes with the wavelength. And due to the wavelength change, there's a color change. And that's why the change of the color when you are heating the metals are going to happen. And this all some information that you can get back reading the heat transfer book, you'll find. This information that are given in the figure are also given in the form of a table here, table 131A, is showing us the wavelength and the corresponding approximate value of falling radiation into with this or corresponding to this wavelength. The 1367 is an average value for the whole spectrum. But this, there are some values that are less than that, some values that are greater than that, so that the average is 1367. And here it's giving you the details, how much is radiation, which is corresponding to this lambda. Actually, it is not really corresponding to the lambda, which is given here, but it is somewhere between 0.175 and 0.225. So the average is the 0.25, and the corresponding value is this. And this is the fraction of this energy, which is the subtotal emissive power, which is basically the energy extended from a wavelength of zero to this wavelength. It is integrated to be given that fraction. And this is the fraction corresponding to the 0.3 and so on. So this is the wavelength, an average wavelength. And this is the average energy associated with this wavelength. And this is fraction of the total energy, which is covered by a wavelength that extended from 0 to 0.25. And this is, for example, the fraction of the energy, which is extended from 0 to 1.1. This is the energy, which is, for example, fraction of the energy given from a wavelength of 0 to a wavelength of 8, and so on. Here's this an example of how to make use of this table. The example is saying, calculate the fraction of extraterrestrial solar radiation and the amount that radiation in the ultraviolet, which is given in the range of lambda less than 0.38, the visible light, where lambda is somewhere between 0.38 and 0.78 micrometer, and the infrared range, where lambda is greater than 0.78 micrometer portions of the spectrum. So we're talking about solar energy coming from the sun, and the values are varying depending on the wavelength. Now we need to see how much is given in the ultraviolet, which is of that range, the visible range, which is this, and the infrared, which is this. Now let's look at these. We are talking about basically a couple of values that are specified here. One of them is the 0.38, the other is the 0.78. And there is what's below this, what's in between, which is the visible light, and what's greater than this. So we're going to look at this from the table so that we can see we're interested in this fraction, which is F, from zero to the specified wavelength. And we are going to look get these values corresponding to the 0.38 and the 0.78. I'm going to get back again to the table so that we can look at this. 0.38 is here. So the fraction of radiation is 0.064. The 0.78 is here, and the fraction is 0.554. So these are the two values that we need to extract from here. The 0.64, which is corresponding to this, and the 0.544, which is corresponding to this wavelength. So these values are being extracted from the tables, and here they are. 0.38 corresponding is 0.64, and for the 0.78 micrometer, the corresponding value of F0 to lambda is 0.544. So fraction of the ultraviolet is 0.64. Fraction of the visible range is the difference between these two values, 0.48. And the fraction of the infrared contribution is 0.465. If you're going to add this to this to this, it will count to 1, which is the total energy falling. Now, each one of them is contributed to a fraction of the solar constant. So for the wavelength from 0 to 0.38, which is representing the ultraviolet, 0.064 of the 1367 is basically 87 watt per meter square. In the visible range, 0.48 of the 1367, 0.48 times 1367, it gives 656 watts per meter square. And then in the infrared region, what the remainder from 0.78 to infinity, then this 4.56 multiplied by the 1367 gets 623. So out of this quantity of 1367, 78 watt per meter square is in the ultraviolet range, 656 is in the visible range, and 623 watt per meter square is in the infrared range. Now, this can be repeated for whatever wavelengths, probably, for example, we'll say that in the, the visible range is given by 7 colors. These colors are having different wavelengths. So that, for example, we can say for how much of or the fraction which is given in the red or the blue or the cyan or whatever. This is again some sort of a replot or redistribution of the table in a different way. You can see here, previously it was given with the wavelength as the independent variable. Let me go back again to the figure. The first one here was the wavelength, and then the corresponding G, and then the corresponding range. Now, this is replotted so that that range is the measure, or basically it is the independent variable, and others are being calculated accordingly. And that results in this table here from F that goes from 0 to 0.05. So here it is given equal partitions in terms of the energy band, and then the corresponding wavelength, and where is the midpoint of the wavelength, which is basically the point in the middle between these two. The 0.3 plus 0.364 divided by 2 will get the 0.328. So that's the range of the wavelength where this fraction of the energy is being occupied. Now, the variation of the extraterrestrial radiation is due to two sources. The two sources are basically, first is variation in the radiation emitted by the sun. However, there are some conflicted results about the radiation emitted from the sun. Is it constant? Is it changed? And if it's changed, how much does it change? So that's something we are going to assume that it's a constant because of the uncertainties in the values are basically within a very small range. So we're going to assume that the energy, which is basically the value of the solar constant, it's assumed to be a constant value. It will not change. The second is the variation from the Earth. Yes, go ahead.
Is the assumed constant during the day, you mean? Or whenever you are?
Solar constant, which is reaching the Earth, is almost constant regardless, day or night, winter or summer. And then what is going to change is the orientation of the Earth, which is allowed to use it or use a part of it during the day. And a part of the Earth will not be facing it during the night, so it will not get it at all. But outside the atmosphere, this is the quantity of energy which is always reaching from the sun. You get my point?
Okay, clear, clear.
Now, the second is the variation. We said that Earth is rotating around the sun, but the rotation is not at a single distance. The distance changes, and the change of the distance is not significant. Actually, it changes only within a 3.3%. And you can see that here, there's variations from a value here to another value, and these variations are basically going through a certain pattern, but it is not too much difference. It's the 3.3% as been mentioned. The first thing that we'll be seeing here in terms of the calculations is the G-on, which is basically called the extraterrestrial radiation incident on the plane normal to the radiation in a certain day of the year. That's something that can be seen here. And actually this has been used in plotting the previous figure. Because in the previous figure, what we have seen basically in the x-axis, it's the months. So January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December. How these are going to be different? They are different in terms of days. So we do normally start with a parameter N here. N is the day in the year. For example, 1st of January is day number one. Today we are 19th of January, so today is the day number 19 in the year. So N is equal to 19 today. At 31st of December, N is equal to 365. So that's the how the N is going to be considered here. And this is a part maybe we can start by looking at or anticipating that through the value of N, we can see, for example, how much is the inclination angle. We'll be defining the inclination angle in due course. How much is the energy falling into a certain surface at a certain orientation. So that's something that through this N, we're going to be able to calculate that. So the G on is the extraterrestrial radiation incident on a plane normal to the radiation on a certain day of the year. And this value is calculated based on the solar constant and the number of the day over the year, which is N. B again is a function of N. The 360 here, this is a whole rotation, and the 365 is the total number of days over the year.
Doctor, 360 represent what?
Again?
360 represent what?
It's the total rotation around a certain axis. You see, a circle rotates, okay, or a point in a circle to make makes a full rotation on an angle of 360.
Okay.
Now, what is next here are some sort of definitions. I would probably start talk about, we're going to go read through the definitions, but I urge you from here to next class, which is Wednesday, please go through these slides. It is this slide, talk about the definitions, all the slides that are dealing with the definitions. You have to know these definitions quite well, because we are going to make use of them always. For example, we are going to use the zenith, and the zenith angle is going to be utilized all the time. So you should know what does it mean. Meridian, you should know what does it mean. For example, this is a meridian that starts from the North Pole and extends again down to the South Pole. And it is the meridian that holds the changes in times. And prime meridian is the one, the line that passes through Greenwich, which is used as a source of defining the time. So the zenith is imaginary point directly above a particular location. So if you are sitting at a certain location and you look vertically upward, then you are going to get what's called the zenith. Above means vertical direction, opposite to the gravitational force. So it's just vertically moving up. The opposite direction of the zenith is what's called the nadir. Meridian, again, this is the longitude, Khat al-Tul, it's an imaginary line extending from the North Pole to the South Pole and having the zero meridian passing by Greenwich. And then every meridian is having a difference between the other one in terms of about 4 minutes or so. Prime meridian, as I mentioned, this is the one passing by Greenwich. Air mass, we're going to use air mass in due course as we relate it to the zenith angle. In some calculations related to the solar energy, you may need this value. The definition is the ratio of mass of atmosphere through which beam radiation passes to the mass of atmosphere if the sun is located as the zenith angle. The issue of the mass of the air, when you look at it in Wikipedia, for example, it will tell you that this is a mass of a certain volume of the air that may change from one location to the other, depending on how much humid is it, depending on the nature of the earth below it. So that affects this kind of mass of the air. And here, the air mass is being defined here. And the definition is going to say that it would be calculated approximately for a zenith angle. We did not define the zenith angle so far, but we'll just take the definition as is now until we next time look at what is meant by the zenith angle and the rest of angles that are needed for our calculations. So the mass or the air mass is basically one divided by cosine, the zenith angle, and this is there for up to a zenith angle of 70. After that, the Earth curvature is going to affect it might be hiding the visibility from the sun, and that's something we'll be discussing next time. So M is equal to 1 when the sun is at the zenith, and for an angle of 60, actually cosine 60 is 30, so that this is where M might be equal to 2. So it's a value that might be used in our calculations at as the time passes. Now it's about the time of classes, so I'm going to stop here. I urge you, please, go ahead the previous slides and continue a little bit with the definitions so that we can start with it from here next time, inshallah. Questions?
Doctor, when ME41, does it mean that it is the sun is normal to the earth or to that point?
Actually, the sun is normal to the location where we are doing the measurement. On top of us, then it may change if your location has changed.
This is what does M mean, isn't it?
This is basically that ratio of mass of the atmosphere relative to the rate to the mass of the atmosphere if the sun is just right above us in the location we are in.
Okay.
Right?
Thank you.
Fine, you're welcome. So if no further questions.
Yes, doctor.
Yes, go ahead, please.
Do you have a time after the class? So I have some questions for you.
Yes, I may have not too much time because I have some other engagements, maybe like 5 minutes or so if you are going to still be there.
Okay, no problem. I just want to ask you about the emails I sent you yesterday about the situation.
Oh, yes. Okay. So it's not only regarding you, it's regarding four, Basim, Muhammad, Omar, Ziyad. Is that right?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. That's it. Yeah, fine. So that's it for us today. We'll see you next time, inshallah. And
Doctor, excuse me.
Thank you.